Good afternoon. Welcome to Present True Fellowship Church in St. Joseph, Missouri. Today we have our study called Gleanings in the Word. I believe that it's imperative for the body of Christ to know the Word of God. I think that it's been neglected and it's not preached in the pulpits much anymore. It's more psychology and the Word of God is neglected in the church anymore. And it is the only thing that's going to change us or set us free. So as we continue this study on the Holy Spirit, this will be part four that we start today. And we're so appreciative of all those who watch this video as we, my heart's desire is for you to understand not only the Word of God, but the Holy Spirit and how He moves and what He is. Now, I've said this many times, and I believe the Holy Spirit, I believe in the Trinity. I believe the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I believe they're all three, but they're one. And so it's hard to explain or understand how it works, but it is. That is the way it is. And so I believe that the third person of the Trinity, he's personal. He has feelings, and if he wasn't a person, he couldn't be grieved or vexed or any other number of things that we can cause him to withdraw from us. And so last week we was talking about the different descriptions of the Holy Spirit in the Bible. And so let us go to the Lord in prayer first off. Father, we are grateful today to be in your house. We are humble to be in your presence. Father, we are so thankful for your word and thankful for the Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us into all truth, Father. We humbly submit ourselves to you today, God, and ask that you will use us for your glory and your honor. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Last week, we ended with talking about the symbols of the Holy Spirit, and we talked about the voice of the Holy Spirit. I'd like to pick up this week on the wind, the symbol of the wind of the Holy Spirit. Listen to what Scripture says in John 3:8. It says, "The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh. And whether it goeth, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit." That's John 3:8. The wind bloweth where it listeth. It describes the Holy Spirit as a wind. Listen to Acts 2:2. That's Acts 2:2. That was John 3:8. This is Acts 2:2. "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting." How did it come? It came suddenly from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, the sound of a rushing mighty wind. Now listen to what John 20 verse 22. "And when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, Receive you the Holy Ghost." What did he do? He breathed on them and he said, "Receive the Holy Ghost." Now, the wind has several purposes. If you really think about what the wind does, it has a purpose. It's refreshing on a hot summer day. Just like today, they say the heat index is going to be 101. Well, a cool breeze is very welcome this time of type of weather. Today, it refreshes us. It helps us, does it not? And also the wind blows away all the chaff in our life. Now, let me explain what they're saying about chaff. In the old days, because everything in the Bible is something that was performed in the Hebrew, and so I want you to understand what they're talking about when he talks about the chaff. When they would go to the threshing floor, and they would grind out the wheat, and it would throw it up in the air, and the wind would catch the chaff and blow it away, and only the wheat would come down. Now, God that is the same way that, that the Holy Spirit operates in our life. He begins to blow away all the chaff in our life. And what is the chaff in our life? Well, it can be any number of things. It can be anything that hinders your walk with the Spirit. It can be anything that hinders your relationship with God, because is that not the most precious thing in your life, that relationship you have with God? Now, listen, that chaff in our life is what sometimes hinders our process with God. You know, I don't believe God never forsakes us. But sometimes we are so bullheaded and we're so obstinate that we refuse to listen to the Holy Spirit. And what God is not trying to punish us or make our life miserable, but God is trying to bring us into that place of righteousness and holiness in Him, so that we reflect the image of His Son. Now, that's what the Holy Spirit does. He reveals Jesus through us, and so as we allow the Holy Spirit to work in our life, He begins to get rid of the chaff in our life. He begins to get rid of the things that are hindering us. It can be. Well, let's just take for some instance. What would you consider chaff in your life? Just think about that for a minute. What would you consider as chaff in your life? I think that we all have something in our life that we're battling, that we have a hard time overcoming, and the Holy Spirit is trying to get rid of that out of our life. He's blowing on that situation. It can be anger. Maybe you're an angry person, and so, well, I'm a Christian, but I know a lot of Christians that have anger in them, you know? And so the Holy Spirit is always going to work toward getting rid of that anger in your life, because He knows that it's detrimental to your spiritual walk. Or it can be you have a mean spirit. Now, I don't really understand how a Christian can have a mean spirit, but I've met people who profess to be Christians. All I can do is go by how they live their lives and how they reflect Him. And to me, meanness does not reflect the image of the Savior whatsoever. So really, that is not a good illustration on my part. But there can be that anger in our life. We can be an angry person. And really, even that is hard to understand with a Christian. But we all battle these things in our life. And sometimes, you know, all our life, maybe we were a mean person, but Christ came into our life and He began to change us in the inside out. But it doesn't mean we're completely changed right off. It says it's by the renewing of their mind. It's a process that's going on in our life, that God begins to change us, begins to blow the chaff out of our life. He allows the Holy Spirit to work on the inside of us so that we reflect Him on the outside. And so we battle these battles with this flesh, and really probably the flesh is the chaff. That is what God is working on. Paul said, I die daily. And so sometimes it's a constant battle to die to self, to die to that old nature. And so well, how can that be? But God doesn't really take the sinful nature out of us. He represses it, but He gives us a new nature. He says, behold, all things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We're a new creature in Christ, but we still have the propensity of our old nature within us, that old character, that way we thought, the way we acted, the way we treated people, that propensity is still within us. So there's this battle going on in your life. The flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, because the flesh wants to hate and be mean and bigotry and all those things, but the Spirit wants to love and have compassion and caring. And so there's this battle that wages on, and I believe this is the work of the Holy Spirit, the wind of the Holy Spirit. It begins to blow the chaff out of our lives. It also ignites the embers in our life, because sometimes you remember Paul wrote to Timothy, stir up the gift that lies within you, because we have this, sometimes we become neglectful of our spiritual life. And the Holy Spirit is always going to try to ignite the embers. So what happens when a fire dies down, but there's still hot coals? And you'll lay some fresh tinder on there, and you'll blow on them hot coals, and it'll flame up. And so the Holy Spirit is always blowing on the coals of our life to ignite us, to excite us, so that we begin to love God like we're supposed to. Because really, really think about this. Love really ignites you. Love really brings you to the place where you're consumed by it at times. And I believe God wants us to begin to be ignited in our love, in our love toward Him. He wants us to love Him like He asked. He said to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. And He said the second commandment is the same as the first, to love thy neighbor as thyself. And on these two commandments hinges all the law. And so the Holy Spirit is always going to try to ignite your love toward God and toward men and women around you. He's always going to try to ignite that love so that you begin to love like God loves. And I don't know if we'll ever attain to that. I put something on Facebook. I don't think we can ever comprehend the love of God. I don't think we'll ever know the true meaning of God's love till we get to heaven. And then we'll experience the love of God unchained, unhindered. We'll experience such a love that it'll flood us so much that we won't be able to stand it. You know, I think about how people don't love God today. They don't allow the Holy Spirit to ignite that in their lives. They don't allow Him to blow because they'd rather be mean to somebody. They'd rather hate somebody, or they'd rather treat somebody badly. Because brother and sister, we have no excuse. We have no excuse whatsoever about not loving. You cannot stand before God and justify why you treated somebody badly or you didn't love them. You won't be able to do it. You won't be able to stand before them. And so I want you to understand today about the wind of the Holy Spirit. He wants to do a work in our life. He wants to blow upon our lives. And we need that wind. Now, the third symbol of the Holy Spirit is a cloud. And we find this in Exodus 13, verse 21. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night. Then in Exodus 24, 15, and that was Exodus 13, 21. I don't want to get too fast. I want you to understand these scriptures. Exodus 24, 15, and Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. It was in that cloud that Moses received, among many other instructions, commands on how to build the tabernacle. While in the cloud, Moses shared such a close relationship with God that his face would often shine from that. And they even put a veil over his face because there was such an appearance of God's glory upon him. Now here's the wonderful news. The same cloud that enveloped Moses dwells in you. It's in you. That cloud was the Holy Spirit. He dwells in you. The Holy Spirit is God's abiding presence in us. He was the cloud that guided the children of Israel through the wilderness. See, the children of Israel had not experienced God like we have experienced God. They built a tabernacle for the presence of God to come down and inhabit a tabernacle. But now each one of us are the temple or the tabernacle of God, and the presence of God dwells within us. The cloud of glory has filled us, and we have experienced His presence wherever we go. That means when you're at Walmart, the presence of God is there. When you're in a car driving down the street, the presence of God is with you. When you're at work doing your job, the presence of God is with you. You realize how powerful that is? That the creator of everything, the one who all he had to do was speak and it was so. He created something out of nothing. Nobody can do that but God. He spoke it into existence and it happened. He said, let there be light, and there was light. But do you realize that he created light before he created the sun and the moon? He said, let there be light. But then on down in the verses, he talks about creating the sun and the moon where we receive our light from. And so, let there be light. Maybe he was talking about Jesus. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Wow. He said, let there be light. Now, I didn't mean for this to do this, but it did it anyway. There we go. So the Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of fire, of cloud, and provided light at night with a pillar of fire. This is allowed them to travel by day or by night in Exodus 13:21. You know what? Some people, it seems like they say, my life's just full of darkness. But even in darkness, you have light because he's within you. His presence is within you. He takes care of you. He guides you. His presence is with you. In the same way the Holy Spirit guided the children of Israel through the wilderness, so he guides you today. To stay within the will of God, simply follow the Holy Spirit. How simple is that? You know, when I was a little boy, been just a couple of years ago, but when I was a little boy and I lived at home with my dad, I had to do his will, what he wanted me to do. It was his will. And you know, there's always that, as a young man, as you grow up, the wills always collide, you know, even with my son and me. But, and it's hard for a father to let go sometimes. But anyway, so the Holy Spirit, very simple, is that you follow him, you do his will, and you're following him. Amen. There's a saying I have that I use whenever I sense God changing my direction in life or ministry: the cloud is moving. Now, in this church, the cloud's been moving a lot. This July, we'll be celebrating our 7th year in this building. If you'd have told me 7 years and 2 months ago, I would have told you you're crazy. This won't never happen. But God made a way where there seemed to be no way. We were in the will of the Holy Spirit, and he prepared the way for us. He went ahead of us, and he showed us the way. He was the light, the presence of God, and he showed us the way. We leased the building for a 3-year lease with option to buy. Part of our payment was going for the down payment, and so God just worked it out. That in a year and a half, we were able to purchase the building. And I'm telling you, it was a miracle. There was no way we could be able to purchase that building. Our finances were not in the place to do that, but God made a way where there seemed to be no way. We here at this church, we are so thankful. I'm telling you, we're humble by what God has done. And it's all because we've allowed the will, we've simply followed the Holy Spirit's leading, and we've stayed in the will of the Father, and he has blessed the work of God. I can tell you that when we started this church, we had very few members. We really didn't have the finances to make a payment every month. But we felt God, so we purged ahead. We followed the leading of the Holy Spirit. And you know what he done? We've never missed a payment. We've never been late on a payment. Our insurance is always paid on time. Our church payment is always paid on time. All the other obligations had, they're always paid on time and paid in full. Now, we was just looking here. I think we paid in almost $30,000 has been paid in on the debt of this building. Now, you know what I'm really believing? We're going to double up on that in the next few years. We're going to believe God that we're going to be able to get this building paid off in half the time. I think we have a 15-year note, I think it is. So, and oh my goodness, if we're going to believe that, it's we're almost halfway there. Wow. Anyway, I guess God can do it. You know, he could do a miracle. He could cause someone to give us the money we need to pay the building off. But anyway, that cloud is always moving. The presence of God is always moving. We have to learn to follow his presence. And that is just by obeying the leading of the Holy Spirit, by listening to that voice. So how do you know the voice of the Holy Spirit? Well, he's the one who will tell you, you shouldn't do that. You remember your mama? Don't you do that. You know that's not right. Well, that's the Holy Spirit. You feel that within your subconscious. He begins to direct your path, and he begins to change your direction and change your person. I don't know that he changes our personality, but he changes us, our character. We're not the character we used to be, but we're a new character or a new person in Christ, however you want to say that. Even Peter said that we are partakers of his divine nature, of God's divine nature. And people say, well, what is God's divine nature? Well, God's divine nature is found over in Galatians 5:23, the fruit of the Spirit. That's God's nature. And so we had that leading of the Holy Spirit. How do we know? You remember that Elijah was on the mount. He had ran from Jezebel, and he was hiding out, and he was in a cave, and there was a great earthquake and a great thunderstorm and loud, and all it was very loud. And then all of a sudden there was this still small voice, and Elijah knew it was God. Pardon me. Some people think it's only God when it's just a bunch of hoopla, a bunch of shaking and roaring and noisy. At that moment, and I ain't saying sometimes that is God. Sometimes we do get excited about God. But in that moment of his life, it was that still small voice. It wasn't all the clamor. God got him down to that place of where he could hear his voice. I'm telling you, sometimes we get caught up in all the hoopla things, but we just need to take time to be with God and to hear his voice, to learn to hear his voice through all the noise. And so sometimes you just got to get that apart so you can know his voice, that you can know it. Even when you get back into that situation, even there's a lot of noise, but you can still hear that still small voice. Listen to what it says in 2 Chronicles 5:13 through 14. This is 2 Chronicles 5:13 through 14. It came even to pass, as the trumpeters and singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voices with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endureth forever." Then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord have filled the house of God. Wow. They couldn't even stand in the presence of an awesome God as he filled the temple. We take this for granted. This is awesome that God had made us his temple, that he fills this temple with his glory. He fills us with everything we have need of. Oh my goodness, brother and sister, we are living so far beneath what God has prepared for us. We can't even conceive or think in the hearts of our mind what he has done or prepared for us. We take what God has done so lightly. I thank God every day for every, I try to thank him for everything I can think of that he's done. And you know what? I thank him for things that he does. I don't even realize he had a hand in, but I realize after all, he did have a hand in it. And so we take all this for granted here, but what would it be like if we would come to church this Sunday, wherever you go, and the glory of God would come down? So much that he would fill this house, that his very essence would permeate the air so that we would fall down. You know what? See, people, think about this. I think that if we ever got in that place with God, we would fall flat on our faces. And we'd realize how unworthy we are to be in the presence of such a holy God, such a God that we've never... Oh my goodness, I'm really touched today by this. And I always think of Isaiah. Here was a prophet of God, and he'd just come back from burying the king Uzziah, and he loved Uzziah, and he was a friend to him. And Uzziah, he died in unfortunate circumstances. He began well, but he ended sadly. So anyway, he comes to the temple. And when he walks into the temple, he sees the Lord high and lifted up. And he sees his train filling the temple. It's like heaven opened up and it filled that temple. And Isaiah's seen the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And his response was, here was a prophet, a man who lived for God as well as he could. Yet he said, woe is me. I'm a man of unclean lips. I'm undone. Brother and sister, if the presence of God would fall in the houses to the churches today, I think we'd all be on our faces crying out to God, please forgive us, God. I think we'd all experience such an awesome presence of him that we could not bear it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We need that in the church today. We need people who begin to allow the presence of God to fill their workplaces, to fill their homes, to fill their jobs. We need the presence of God in Walmart. We need him in every area of our place. We need him in our schools. We need him in our government. We need the presence of God, the influence of his Holy Spirit. The presence of the Holy Spirit also manifests in the form of a cloud at the transfiguration of Jesus. Remember that? That you find that in Matthew 17, verses 5 and 6. Matthew 17, verses 5 and 6. But even as he spoke, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is my dearly beloved Son, who brings me great joy. Listen to him. The disciples were terrified and fell face down on the ground. See? They were in the presence of a holy God. In Mark, it says this, Mark 13:26. It was in a cloud that Jesus ascended. In Acts 1:9, he ascended in a cloud in Acts 1:9. And it is on the cloud that Jesus will return. That's what it says in Mark 13:26. The Holy Spirit, the cloud, reveals the presence of Jesus. The cloud represents the Holy Spirit's guidance and glorious presence in your life. He surrounds you, reveals the glory of God. He rests on his new tabernacle, and that's you. The cloud can be symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Now, you talked about the cloud. We've talked about three things now. The cloud. Wow, my memory's not good today. How can I believe I can't remember that? The cloud, the wind, and the first one was the voice. Now let's talk about the symbol of the fire. Acts 2:3. Once again, we're going to quote from Acts 2:3 because we see two of the symbols in that one verse. Acts 2:3, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them. Excuse me. It wasn't in the same verse. Acts 2:2 and Acts 2:3. It says it came as a suddenly as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the room. Amen. And then in 2:3 it says, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it set upon each of them. The Holy Spirit is symbolized by fire all throughout the scriptures. All throughout this book, this Bible, you're going to find the Holy Spirit is represented by fire. One of the most interesting fire references to me can be found in the book of Ezekiel. And it came, and this is Ezekiel. You'll find this in Ezekiel chapter 8, verses 1 and through 4. And I was reading this last night, and there's something here that I did not quite grasp, and I'm not sure I have yet grasped it, but I know that there's something here that the Holy Spirit wants to show us. Now listen what it says. The Holy Spirit is symbolized by fire. It came about in the sixth year, on the fifth day and the sixth month. As I was sitting in my house with the elders of Judah, setting about me, he was in his house, the elders of Judah were all about him, that the hand of the Lord fell on me there. Then I looked, and behold, a likeness as the appearance of a man from his loins, and downward was the appearance of fire, and from his loins and upward appearance of brightness, and like the appearance of a glowing metal. He stretched out the form of a hand and caught me by the lock of my head, and the Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven and brought me in the visions of God to Jerusalem. He wasn't at Jerusalem, but the Holy Spirit took him there. To the entrance of the north gate of the inner court, where the seat of idol of jealousy, which provokes to jealousy, was located, and behold, the glory of God of Israel was there, like the appearance of which I saw in the plain. Now, I want to dwell on this just for a few minutes today. I believe there's really something here that God wants us to understand. And if you will please allow me, I want us to see some things here. Now, one thing I did want to point out, that in the Old Testament, they called them prophets, but they were also known as seers. And what is a seer? Well, a seer sees visions, all right? And so it's not so much a dream as it's kind of like what Peter was on that rooftop, and it says he fell into a trance, and he's seen a vision of a sheet coming down with all manner of unclean things, and the Lord instructed him, rise and eat, and he said, not so, Lord, I've never ate anything unclean. And three times that happened. And God always kind of speaks to us three times he'll speak to us about that, or he'll confirm something with that. So this vision here he had is has happened since the vision of Chebar, where he had his first vision about how bad Jerusalem was. But listen, he said, I beheld lo a likeness. The vision opens with a theophany, like that in Ezekiel 1 and 1 through 20. But here as there, Ezekiel uses a word which emphasizes the fact that what he had seen was but a likeness of it. It wasn't the very image, but he's seen a likeness of the infallible glory of the image of the unseen. for amber. In this case, we note the absence of the cherubic figure. There is no cherubim spoke of here in this vision. But in the other vision at Chebar, he's seen those cherubims. It is simply the appearance of the title of a tile likeness of the glory seen now in a glow of fire without the milder, more hopeful brightness. Then he said, he's seen in verse 3, he said, the form of a hand. I'm not getting what I want to get out of this. I'm not sure I can right at this moment. But I want us to understand this is the Holy Spirit here, working here. It says, and the Spirit lifted me up. It says the form of a hand. Why does he say form? That's kind of interesting. And really, when you look in the Hebrew, it means a similitude or a pattern of a hand. He sees the form of a hand. He stretched out the form of a hand and caught me by the lock of my head, and the Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven and brought me in the visions of God to Jerusalem. Now, what was the whole purpose of this vision? We were talking about the fire, but maybe I should not. I really don't want... Well, let's talk about it. In this vision, he called this being the Spirit. Ezekiel's vision may very well have been of the Holy Spirit himself. He may have actually seen the Holy Spirit. Now, he said, then I looked and behold a likeness as appearance of a man. And from his loins downward there was appearance of fire, and from his loins upward the appearance of brightness like the appearance of a glowing man. And he stretched out the form of a hand and caught me by the lock of my head, and the Spirit lifted me up. So, is that man, the Holy Spirit? Is that Ezekiel seeing a form of him? It's interesting, is it not? Can I just give you, let's read a few more scriptures here. Let's look at Zechariah 13:9. Now, I have a few of them here. I don't want us to get in a rush with this. There's no reason to get in a rush. Excuse me. Zechariah 13:9 says this. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts of Aaron shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left. I got the wrong. I don't know why I got that scripture. It don't really go with anything. Okay, let's go. Now, I looked at these last night, and I didn't see anything wrong with them. Maybe it was Zephaniah 13. Nope, it's not Zephaniah. 13:9. Let's go back to Zechariah 13, verse 9. Oh, okay, I read the wrong verse. I'm sorry. 13:9, and I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried, and they shall call my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them. What does fire do? It refines us, okay? It purifies us. You know how they take gold and when it's impure in its raw form and they melt it down, and when they smelt that gold at the top, all the impurities float to the top and then they skim out all the impurities. Well, it's what the Holy Spirit, the same thing that the wind does, the fire does in a different way. The fire, sometimes some of us, we need the fire of God in our life. Excuse me. We need that fire of God in our lives. Sometimes, and so the wind and the fire, they kind of work together. Remember that when the wind blowed on the hot coals, it caused the fire to flare up. And so we need that. Listen to what it says in Matthew chapter 3, verse 11 through 12. Matthew chapter 3, starting with verse 11, and we'll read 11 and 12. I indeed baptize you with the water into repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. This is John the Baptist talking. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he shall thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with an unquenchable fire. Now, you remember we talked about the chaff with the wind. That was what, when they throwed up the wheat and the wind would catch the chaff, the stuff that's not any good, and the grain would fall to the ground. And so the Holy Spirit, it really is a combination of things here. And Jesus said that all the chaff is going to be burned up with fire. So all the things in our life that are not pure, all the things that are not of God, they're going to be purged out of us by the fire of God. Chaff, wind, it all works. Isaiah 4:4, that's the next scripture I would like to read. Isaiah 4:4, that's found in Isaiah 4:4. I want you to know where it's found. Isaiah 4:4. How many times did I say it? Four times. In Isaiah 4:4, when the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, and shall purge the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment, by the spirit of burning. Hallelujah. That means he is going to, that spirit is going to consume all the chaff out of your life. Not going to leave anything left but the purity of God. Gold is always represents the glory or the presence of God. If you remember in the tabernacle of Moses and in Solomon's temple, everything, the candlestick was overlaid with gold, and the candlestick and the altar of incense and the table of showbread were all overlaid with gold. And then we went into the holies, the brazen altar and the cherubims all were. In fact, the candlestick, it says, was made out of one beaten work of gold. I mean, it was a solid piece of gold. Now that's a big piece of gold. And this all reflect the glory of God. Gold reflects the glory of God. There's so much in all that, and I don't really want to get into that because we get caught up in stuff. But anyway, the spirit of burning. Okay, now listen, this one more verse here, and let's find this in 1 Thessalonians 5:19. 1 Thessalonians 5:19. Okay. Verse 19 of Thessalonians. Quench not the Spirit. How do you quench the Spirit? You have any ideas how you can quench the Spirit? Oh, I think if you think hard enough, you know how to quench the Spirit. How many times have we quenched the spirit of people when they rose up and they were really trusting and believing God, and we just kind of throw water on their fire, as they used to say. And we are very apt to that, and we're with that with people. I guarantee you, we're going to be that way with the Holy Spirit. We're going to quench him because this is what we do. I'm guilty, so I'm not blaming you for anything. But I'm telling you this: for years, I used to pray, God, use me, use me. And I'd be in this presence, I'd be in the house of God and worshiping, and I'd feel the urgency of the Holy Spirit to step out and give tongues or give give the interpretation or lay hands on the sick. And I would, is that God? I don't think that's God, you know. And that really was quenching the spirit. But thank God he didn't give up on me, that one day I finally stepped out and began to allow the Holy Spirit to minister through me and not to quench him, not to throw water on the fire that's burning within me, the presence of God that wants to come out of me and touch those around me. Man, that's a powerful thing. Powerful, powerful. I mean, tell you, that is so powerful. So quench not the Holy Spirit. You know what? It means to extinguish. That's one of the words. It means to extinguish, to quench it, and to stop the influence of the Holy Spirit. And really, that's what he's kind of saying. Don't you stop the influence of the Holy Spirit, because he is the one who's going to direct and guide us, not anybody else. So the fire represents the Holy Spirit's righteous nature, and he's going to produce that nature in us. And he's going to burn out any impurities that he finds in our life. If he ain't blowing them out, he's going to burn them out. Amen? He's a refining presence. Okay, we talked about the wind, the fire, the voice, the rain. Now we're going to talk about the rain. Number 5. Isaiah 44, verses 3 through 4. Isaiah 44, verses 3 through 4. I want to go back to that just for a minute, to the fire, because I forgot to bring this out. Acts 2 shares an account in which the Holy Spirit is symbolized by fire. The fire of the Holy Spirit gave power and boldness to the early believers on that day. 3,000 souls were added to the church. And why I say this, that fire of the Holy Spirit, because you remember when we read there in Acts, it said that cloven tongues of fire set upon their heads. And it was such a powerful presence of God flooding that building. And it says every one of them were baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they were all speaking in tongues. And it was such a powerful thing that it could not be contained in that upper room, but it spread into the streets. And men thought, hey, these guys are drunk. And Peter, the one who denied Christ 3 times, who would not stand with him in his hour of need, yet on that day he stood boldly and proclaimed, these men are not drunk as you suppose, but this is that which the prophet Joel spoke of, that all the Spirit would be poured out upon all flesh. Come on. And so there was a boldness that come with that Holy Spirit. That fire burned away all the chaff in Peter's life, and he had this boldness now. And he was willing to give his life now for the Lord. He did give his life. It says that Peter was crucified upside down because he felt that he was unworthy to be crucified the same way his Lord was. So I just wanted to bring that out. And it does say in Hebrews 12:29, God is a consuming fire. And what he does, he consumes the things in our lives that are improper, that shouldn't be in a Christian's life. It saddens me to see so many profess to be Christians and their whole life speaks otherwise. They ask, how shall we know them? He said, you shall know them by their fruit. So really, you shall know them by their fruit. That really, when God comes into your life, you're changed. You're not the same anymore. What time is it? Okay, we got a few minutes. Let's start on number 5, rain. Let's read Isaiah 44, verses 3 and 4. He said, for I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. Are you thirsty today? And floods upon the dry ground. Is your ground dry today? I will pour my spirit upon thy seed and my blessings upon thy offsprings, and they shall spring up as among the grass, as willows by the watercourses. Really speaking of a barrenness in people's life, and rain often rejuvenates and brings back. We all, from time to time, enter the place where we find ourselves spiritually tired and drained. Have you ever been there, where you feel like, I got nothing to give? I'm drained. I have nothing more to give. The demands of living pair with a waning prayer life. That's what happens. It can produce a dryness of the soul. When we begin to neglect the things of God, you know that sometimes you can get so busy doing the things of God that you neglect God? God doesn't want that. God wants us to be never to neglect Him. Our prayer life should never be neglected. Our reading of the Scriptures should never be neglected. They should be priorities in our life, because if they ain't, they produce a drought in our life. You ever seen the ground, how it needs rain and it just starts cracking because there's no moisture there, and it becomes barren, and everything dies if there's no rain or no water coming? And so, but you know what? You can take water, you can go to the desert and you can begin to irrigate, and they said life will just blossom up out of that because the water brings life to them. So you may find yourself in places that are dry like the desert. In a spiritual desert, you become tired, frustrated, weak, and apathetic. Responsibilities and needs like the intense heat from the beaming sun drain you of vitality. Boy, I can testify to that. I was out in that sun for a little bit this morning, and I'm telling you, I just was wore out. Because the heat was just repressive and just zapped my strength. And so, brother and sister, if we're not allowing the Holy Spirit to begin to reign in our lives, to begin to bring that moisture into our life, then we become dry and barren, and we can't produce anything. You can't produce love in that atmosphere. You can't produce faith in that atmosphere. You can't even have hope in that atmosphere. When you begin to neglect the things, the rain of the word, the rain of prayer, and you begin to neglect those things that spiritually feed you and nourish you and cause the fruit of the Spirit to be brought forth in your life, you cannot do anything unless you begin to allow the Holy Spirit. So life can sometimes be like a desert, but the Holy Spirit will always be like a river. Listen to what John 7:37 says. Listen, John 7:37. I don't know why this thing is clicking so much today. I'm sorry about that. John 7:37. We're going to read down through verse 39. In the last days, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the Scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they believed on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified." Do you hear that? Jesus referred to the Holy Spirit as the water. Oh, how we need that water in our life, that flowing of the Spirit, that river that flows. I remember years ago, and I hear him still singing, Jimmy Swaggart singing, "There's a river of life flowing out through me, makes the lame to walk and the blind to see, opens prison doors, sets the captive free. There's a river of life flowing out through me." Come on. There's a river flowing out of us. The presence of God is flowing out of us. Because it wants to bring life not only to us, but to all the barrenness around us, all the hurting people, all those who feel like they've been drained and they have nothing more to give. But God wants to bring life, and He wants you to be the one who will bring life to the people around you. That's the purpose of the Holy Spirit. His whole purpose is to share Jesus. Listen to what it says in Isaiah 44, verse 3. Isaiah 44, verse 3. It says this. He says, "For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground, and I will pour my spirit upon that seed, and my blessing upon thy offspring." For I will pour water Give me a few seconds here. "I will pour water upon him that is thirsty." Are you thirsty today? Have you tried everything? I mean, you've tried positive speaking and confessions, and you've done all, you went through the whole gamut of stuff, and you're still thirsty? Because you tried everything but what you need, and that's the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. You need him to fill your life, to quench that thirsting of your soul. Hallelujah. Listen to what it says in John 4:14. John 4:14. That's the next scripture we're going to read today. John 4:14. This is Jesus talking to the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Is that not what we read in John 7:37-39? But whosoever drinketh, it means that you've got to do something about it. You cannot continue to be barren and dry and unproductive. God wants to pour the Holy Spirit into your life, that water that refreshes you and revives you and brings forth life in you. Because you've been so barren and so dry for so long that God longs to fill you with his presence, his love. He wants you to know the thirsting of your soul can be quenched by the Holy Spirit. Oh, quit trying all those gimmicks. Quit trying all those, you know, we had that name it and claim it. We have so many things that's being preached in the name of the Lord. It's not right. It's not factual. Oh, they use a certain amount of truth to it, but it's not the whole truth. It's only the truth that they proclaim. But the whole truth, the whole counsel of God must be proclaimed in this word. Excuse me. And so they neglected the things that God wanted. See, how do we get in error? We begin to neglect the things we need to do. How do we come dry and barren? We quit reading the Bible. We quit praying. We go into the church and we allow the preacher to pray for us and the preacher to preach the word to us. And how we know he's even preaching the right word? If your life is not be changing, then he must not be preaching right. Come on. I often think of myself as if I begin to see changes in people's life, and I know that's the work of the Holy Spirit, because he's taking the word and he's causing it to bring forth life within them. He's reigning on their life with the word, and life is coming forward. The prophet Joel prophesied of the coming rain. He was referring to natural rain, but he went on to prophesy that God would pour out his spirit. The mentioning of the spirit and rain together creates this clear symbolic parallel. The Holy Spirit is the rain of heaven. Listen to what he says in Joel 2:23, verse 28 and 29. "Be glad then, you children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God. For he has given you the former rain and moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. Now, you may not understand this. There was a spring rain and the fall rain. And in this here, he says, he will cause to come down to you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. You're going to combine them. There's going to be such an outpouring. And really, that's probably what he was talking about in Acts. Okay? And he says, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids. In those days I will pour out my spirit. You know God's still pouring out his spirit. He's not done. All you who are thirsty and dry, come and take a drink. Quench that thirsting soul of yours. Water does some things. Water cleanses us. We get dirty in the process of the day. We take a shower. It cleanses us. It quenches us. It refreshes us, and it gives life. The Holy Spirit cleanses your soul, quenches your spiritual thirst, and refreshes your being. Wherever the river and rain of the Holy Spirit touch, there is life. And we're going to close with that. We're a better place to close. Next week, we will pick up on the oil of the Holy Spirit. Going to be good. It's going to be good. I can tell you that right now. I feel it in my spirit already. It's going to be good. I am so excited to teach this series on the Holy Spirit. And I do want to encourage you to follow along with me. And I do offer this material free to you, and you can follow along with me. The outline's in here. You can, and I leave spaces for personal notes and stuff, and you can write on any of this. This would be yours, and I'll mail it to you gladly for free of charge. All you have to do is email me, and that is at tlreynolds1950@gmail.com. tlreynolds1950@gmail.com, and I will send this to you so that you can follow along with me every week. I'm telling you, this will be a blessing to you. This will be something you'll be able to refer to constantly. When somebody talks to you about the Holy Spirit, you can refer to this, and you say, hey, this is what it says in the Word. You don't have to think, but you can know positively if you keep track of this teaching that we're giving. Now, it's never too late. See, all these teachings are on YouTube, and you can always refer back to each one of the teachings so you can catch up on whatever we have done. But I don't want you to miss out on this. I want you to enjoy this and be blessed of God. I'm telling you, it'll be good for you. tlreynolds1950@gmail.com. Well, I think it's been a great time in the Lord today. Great word, I believe. And I really felt the presence of God. And man, don't neglect your spiritual life. There's nothing in this world worth it. Because one day you're going to stand before God. And you're going to have to give an account for your life. I would much rather give a good account of my life than to give, well, God, I didn't serve you like I should. I knew I should, but I did other things, and I kind of put you back in the back. Don't put God last. Put God first. Put him in the center of your life, and let everything else be focused on him. God doesn't want you not to be able to do anything, but God does want you to know him. And for him to be the center and the focus of your life. Let us pray. Father, we're grateful today for this word. We're grateful for the Holy Spirit. Oh God, we all realize sometimes we become dry and thirsty. We neglect our spiritual life, and it causes barrenness within us. Father, we realize that sometimes we've quenched your Holy Spirit, God. And God, please forgive us of all these things, God. And God, begin to let the wind and the fire begin to blow the fire in our life. Ignite us, Father God. Stir our hearts, Father. Oh, God, bless each and every person that's listening. If they need a touch, God, you're a healer. Right now, we pray, God, for healing for each and every one of them. We thank you for it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.